Good morning and welcome to Inverness Christian Fellowship. My name is Karen.
And my name is Robbie, and I want to echo that warm welcome. Whatever it is that you're watching this morning, whether you're watching live on online.church or on Facebook, or whether you're watching this on our YouTube channel as part of Catch Up, we just pray that as you share with us in this service, that you would know God's presence and know His love as you share with us today.
Amen. So this morning we have got Robbie, you're continuing our new devoted series a bit later on. And Jack will be praying before we hear from you. And also Alistair will be reading from God's Word.
So today is the second Sunday of the month, which means for us we spend a little bit of time focusing on Action Overseas, which is the overseas outreach missionary organisation of the Apostolic Church. And we just want to give an opportunity and highlight that there's an opportunity to give into the work of Action Overseas, and you can do that by clicking on the giving button if you're on online.church, or you can go to our website icfchurch.co.uk and then click on the giving link, and then you'll see all the instructions there about how you can give into the work of mission. But if also you can use that same link if you want to give into the work of Inverness Christian Fellowship. Thank you to all of you who already give so generously and faithfully. We give honour to our God, and we thank God for you.
Yeah, and in our weekly newsletter as well that goes out on Thursdays, you will have seen the latest update on Action Overseas as well. So take time to read through and read that and use that as a good prayer guide for our Action Overseas. So before we have a time of worship now, which I know is really difficult in your homes and all the rest of it, and with the tighter guidelines that we now have, that it's only six that can meet together from two different households, and that makes things a little bit more difficult, we know, but we just encourage you to keep pressing in and meet together when you can in coffee shops, and you can meet up with another household and try and connect and keep zooming where you can. But let's read together from Psalm 105, and I'm going to read from the Message version. So it says, Hallelujah. Thank God. Pray to Him by name. Tell everyone you meet what He has done. Sing Him songs. Belt out hymns. Translate His wonders into music. Honor His holy name with hallelujahs. You who seek God, live a happy life. Keep your eyes open for God. Watch for His works and be alert for signs of His presence. Amen. Amen. Let's turn to Him and worship Him together.
Praise the From their tombs, and the angels. Dear Lord, even if we can't meet together in a building today, we're thanking you for the privilege we have that we can meet together in your presence. You are the awesome God. We want to give you all the glory and honor. It's so wonderful to know that you are in control of whatever happens all around the world. And you, the creator of the universe, know that we, your children, are here and you know every one of us by name. It's so wonderful to know you, Lord, and trust all of your promises. When all the world is in fear, you say to us, "Fear not, for I am with you." You say, "I won't abandon or forsake you." You say, "I will be with you for all days until the end of the world." Lord, it's so precious, so beautiful to know that you are with us no matter what. And yet, you have all the answers this world so desperately needs. Please give leaders of this country your wisdom how to tackle current crisis. You gave them power over this nation. Now give them divine wisdom how to use this power. We ask you, Lord, for those who are suffering and unwell. Please bring them comfort and your divine healing. Thank you, Lord, for action overseas and for all those involved in missionary work, wherever they are. Please give them strength and guidance and wisdom and success with whatever they do in your name, in all these places you have sent them to. And please, Lord, when Robbie will be sharing your word, give us full understanding through your Holy Spirit what you want to say to us through his ministry. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Good morning. Once again, I count it a privilege to be able to share God's word with you today. We're continuing in our devoted series, a series that seeks to help us and encourage us to grow deeper in our relationship with Jesus, because we are believing that as we devote ourselves, as we consecrate ourselves, we are believing by faith that tomorrow God will do amazing things among us. Last week, we started looking at the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. And we spent some time focusing on the fact that the God we come to is the perfect Father. He welcomes us, he loves us, and as his child, he desires to give good gifts to us out of his generous heart when we ask him. Prayer cannot become a religious duty, but always be the joy of a child coming before their perfect Heavenly Father. Chris Tomlin said it perfectly in the words of his song, "Good, Good Father," where it says in the chorus, "You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am." We come to this good, good Father on the basis of faith and in Jesus' name. We come on the basis of belief in his word and on the basis of what Jesus has done for us, what he's already doing for us. And we come on the basis of the relationship we now have with our good, good Father through Jesus Christ. I don't want to repeat this morning what we spoke of last week. So if you missed the message last week and you want to find out more about these things, then please go on to our YouTube channel where you can find last week's message. This morning, I want to take some time once again to look at the prayer that Jesus taught us. And specifically, we're going to be looking at this area of how we approach our good, good Father in prayer. So let's read from the passage where Jesus teaches us to pray. And this week we'll be reading it from Matthew's Gospel. So Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 through 15. And this morning, Alistair is going to read for us today.
The scripture reading today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 5 to 15. When you pray, don't be like the hypocrites who love to pray publicly on street corners and in the synagogues where everyone can see them. I tell you the truth, that is all the reward they will ever get. But when you pray, go away by yourself. Shut the door behind you and pray to your Father in private. Then your Father, who sees everything, will reward you. When you pray, don't babble on and on as the Gentiles do. They think their prayers are answered merely by repeating their words again and again. Don't be like them, for your Father knows exactly what you need even before you ask Him. Pray like this: Our Father in heaven, may your name be kept holy. May your kingdom come soon. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the food we need, and forgive us our sins, as we have forgiven those who sin against us. And don't let us yield to temptation, but rescue us from the evil one. If you forgive those who sin against you, your Heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you refuse to forgive others, your Father will not forgive your sins. Amen.
Amen, and may God add a blessing to the reading of His word. Last week, I spoke of this welcoming, generous, loving Father who longs to give us what we ask for. But as we go through this prayer that Jesus taught us, we begin to get some perspective to avoid us having that wrong view that sees God as some kind of bottomless wallet that just wants to spoil His children by giving them whatever they want. How we approach our good, good Father in prayer will help us understand what to pray for. And the first aspect of approaching our Heavenly Father in prayer is with worship, praise, and thanks. Verse 9, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. God, our Father, is a holy God. He is to be greatly revered and honoured. We acknowledge who He is. We to have that feeling of deep respect and awe of who we come before. We approach God with worship, praise, and thanksgiving. They are closely related, but each one is distinct. Each one is important. To some people, worship is more about modern bands and synths. It's about holy or hymns of sovereign reverence. People have expressed worship in different ways in various denominations, traditions, and cultures throughout the history of the church. But how is worship defined in the Bible? The most common words translated worship in the Bible mean to kneel or lay face down before someone as an act of reverence. So to worship God means to lay one's self before God. Both the primary words in Hebrew and Greek for worship in the Bible mean the same thing, to bow down or to lay one's face to the ground. It's an acknowledgement of God's glory. There is someone who is transcendent and glorious, and He is worthy of our full allegiance and devotion. The word worship in English means to acknowledge and ascribe worth to someone or something. The biblical words describe the actual act of worship, that of kneeling, that of bowing, or lying prostrate on the ground. The English translation describes the reason we would do what the Bible says. Psalm 95 verse 6 described the act of biblical worship with two synonyms. It says, O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. So worship is to bow down or lay our face before God. The physical act, this physical act is worship when it reflects the heart's posture to follow the King. We are called, as it says in John 4:24, to worship Him in spirit and in truth. It says God is spirit, and those who worship Him must worship Him in spirit and truth. To worship in spirit is to be led by the living God, to know that joy that comes from fellowship with the Holy Spirit. Our experience of worship can be alive when we worship in the Spirit. True worship must first be in the Spirit, led by the Spirit, and involves our spirit, the inmost part of our being, our connection to God, who is Spirit, by the Holy Spirit, who is within us. To worship in truth is to ground our life in God's truth, in His eternal word, the Bible. We cannot worship however we want and do whatever we feel like. To worship is to bow before God and to delightfully follow His orders. We get to do what God says and not follow after the sin that used to enslave us. The tendency of worship in spirit without the word is lawlessness. We might love Jesus, but if we don't do what He commands, then we don't really love Him. It's merely lip service. And the tendency of worship in truth without the Spirit is legalism. We might do the right things, but if our hearts are not encountering the living God, then we miss the point of the whole thing. Truth is a person, and His name is Jesus. As Matt Redman says in his song, I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about You. It's all about You, Jesus. If worship is heart, then praise is vocal. Psalm 48 verse 1 says, Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. Praise is vocal. It's the response of the human heart to the greatness of God. You can never waste your time praising God. Hebrews 13 verse 15 says, Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that openly profess His name. We have so much to praise God for every single day. There's great power in giving honour to Him. It's easy to praise God when we see His hand at work, when we see His power released, when we see lives changed, prayers answered, the way that we prayed them. Yet the reality is, a lot of the time, daily struggles or constant life demands can crowd out our praise. Sometimes it really is a sacrifice to offer praise. We may not feel like it. We may be struggling. We're weary. Or maybe we feel like God has let us down. He may seem distant to us, like He doesn't really care about what we're struggling through or worrying about. Here's what can make a lasting difference: when we make that decision to fix our eyes upon Him and give daily our praise to Him, no matter what is staring us in the face. There's great power in our acknowledgement in that whatever we are facing today, He is worthy, above all else, of our praise. What matters is this: our hearts are in tune with our Creator and King, pressing in close to Him. Psalm 100, verses 4 and 5 say, Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. For the Lord is good and His love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. We enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Our thanksgiving makes God's greatness particular to our case. Every prayer we offer is to be with thanksgiving. Philippians 4, verse 6 says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God." The more we thank Him for what He's done, the easier it becomes to ask Him for what He's going to do. We approach God with worship, praise, and thanks. That's the first aspect. The second aspect is renouncement of self-will. Matthew 6, verse 10, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." We get an insight into the prayers of Jesus in Hebrews 5, verse 7, where it says, "During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission." Jesus is our example. He was heard because of his reverent submission. Nowhere else do we see this more but in Matthew 26, verse 39, where Jesus prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will." We have to approach God in prayer, prepared to renounce our self-will. Where our will and God's will are in conflict, then it's God's will that must prevail. Ephesians 4, verse 22 to 24, tell us that you were taught, with regard to your former way of life, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. There are two selves in conflict. We have to put off the old. This is not something that God does for us. Ephesians 4:22 says that we were taught to put off our old self. Maybe we've not been taught that putting off our old self is something that we have to do. We have a choice to make. Maybe we've been waiting on God to do it for us. But God is waiting for us to make the choice to surrender our will in our old self and embrace His will as we put on our new self. Am I praying for something because I want it or because God wants it? Does God want me or someone I'm praying for to be healed? Or do I want myself or that other someone to be healed? Does God want those who come against me to be proved wrong, or do I want myself? Is that what I want? What is it that God wants? What is it that we want? We have to put off our old self with what we want and embrace our new self with what God wants. If we are trying to force our will, then there is no room for the will of God. Three things to remember. God loves you. God understands you. And God wants the best for you. And when we allow our minds to be transformed, as it says in Romans 12:2, then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing and perfect will. Prayer is not to get God to do what we want, but to allow God to use us as instruments to what He wants. And let's not limit what God wants, because when we are aligned with His will, then it says in Ephesians 3:20 that He is able to do immeasurably more than we can ask or imagine, according to His power that is at work within us. Let's not forget the second part of that verse. Last week I mentioned that prayer is two-way. It's not just speaking, but it also involves us listening. And listening is something that many of us struggle to do because our minds are filled with so many other things. So we need to meditate on God's word. Take some time each day to fill our minds with His words, because what God has to say to us is so much important than what we have to say. King David in the Old Testament had it on his heart to build a house for God, to build a temple, a worthy prayer, something that would bring glory to God. And when David shared that desire with the prophet Nathan, the prophet Nathan said, go ahead and do it. Go and do whatever is on your heart. But the Lord had different ideas, and the Lord spoke to Nathan and the prophet, and it was because it was not God's will for David to build the temple, but Solomon, his son, would do it. David wanted to build a house for God, but God told David through the prophet Nathan in 2 Samuel 7:11 that the Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you. David wanted to build a house for God, but it was God's will that God would build a house for David. And as we know, Jesus, the Saviour of the world, our Saviour, is a son of David. And David responds in 2 Samuel 7:21, for the sake of your word and according to your will, you have done this great thing and made it known to your servant. David prays then on the basis of the word spoken to him. God's will was more important than his own. God was able to do immeasurably more than he could have asked or imagined according to the power at work within him. You know, and if you were to read that prayer of David in 2 Samuel 7, you will see it overflowing with worship, with praise, with thanks, as David surrenders his will to God's will, and he is blown away by God, the greatness and goodness of God towards him. When we surrender our will to his will, our prayers become faith-filled. They become full of belief that God will do it, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We approach God with worship, praise, and thanks. We approach God renouncing our self-will. And the third aspect of approaching God is recognizing that God will not always give us what we want, but will always give us what we need. Matthew 6:11, give us today our daily bread. It says in 2 Peter 1:3 that his divine power gives us everything that we need to live a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. So why pray for our daily needs when he has given us everything we need already? Because prayer recognises that we are dependent upon him for everything that we need daily. Matthew 6:8 says that we need to pray for our needs, even though Father knows what you need before you ask him. God knows what we need every day, but it's important that we ask in accordance with his will to provide us with all that we need to live each day for him. This keeps us grateful. It keeps us thankful. It keeps us dependent. It allows us to give him praise and thanks for his provision to us. It allows us to worship him for his faithfulness to us. When we're focused on praying for our needs each day, knowing that God will supply them, then we are less worried about tomorrow. For as Jesus says in Matthew 6:34, don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. God will always give us what we need, but not always what we want. Paul testifies to this in 2 Corinthians 12, verses 7 through 9, that in order to keep me from being conceited, I was given a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in your weakness. Paul wanted God to take away his thorn in the flesh. God did not give Paul what he wanted, but God did give Paul what he needed, his grace. And Paul was satisfied with what God gave him. Yes, it took Paul praying for the same thing multiple times before he understood what God was saying to him about it. And when we are praying for the same thing multiple times, we have to be open to what God is wanting to say to us about it and accept it. We can't ignore what God says and keep on praying for the same thing time after time. We need to keep open and receive His will for us. We need to be careful that we don't miss what God wants to give us because we're so focused on what we want. Yield to His will and receive what God wants to give us, and let go of what we want. Be satisfied with God's will for us. Once more, it's about accepting God's will over our own will. You know, Romans 1 verses 18 through 32 is a terrifying picture of God's wrath against sinful humanity. And it says in verse 18 that it starts with suppression of truth. It goes on, and in verse 24 we hear a terrifying statement. Therefore God gave them over in the sinful desires of their hearts. There is a danger, I believe, that when we keep on suppressing God's word, God's will, God's truth in our prayers, and keep on thinking that we're the ones being wise, and keep on pressing God for what we want, and ignoring what He is saying to us about it, then God may give us over to the sinful desires of our heart, and it will not turn out good. But you may think, hang on, Psalm 34 verse 7 says, take delight in the Lord and He will give you the desires of your heart. Surely that's God giving us what we want if we delight in Him. Wrong. You delight in Him. So you delight, that means you delight in His ways. You delight in His purposes. And as you delight in Him, in His ways and in His purposes, His glory, then you discover that God puts a desire in your heart about what He wants to accomplish through you. In other words, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And when God puts His word, His purpose in your hearts, and we pray into that, then we discover, like King David discovered, that God is able to do immeasurably more than we can ask or imagine, according to His transformational power at work within us. So that it's God that gets the glory. It's to the praise and glory of the Father, which makes us worship, praise and thank Him all the more, and makes us desire even more to choose to always seek His will and suppress our will when we come to Him in prayer. So in conclusion, how are we approaching our Father in prayer? Is it with a heart that seeks to offer ourselves to Him, a heart that longs to worship Him? Is it with a voice with which to praise Him no matter what? Is it with a tongue to thank Him for what He has done, where every petition contains thanks, to have that attitude of gratitude? Do we approach God ready to surrender our will in favour of His will? And when He shows us His will, are we ready to pray in faith for His will to be fulfilled and basically ditch anything associated with what we wanted? Are we approaching Him knowing His care for us, knowing that He knows what we need, and are we ready to acknowledge our dependence upon Him to give us what we need? Not what we want, but what we need. And are we ready to receive what He wants to give us, even if it's not what we've asked for? Are we ready to accept His good gifts to us? In our approach to God in prayer, are we ready to lay ourselves before Him? One of His disciples in Luke 11, 1 said to Jesus, Lord, teach us to pray. We've so much to learn or relearn. And my prayer is that as you approach God in prayer this week, that may your petitions be in that context of worship, praise and thanks, in line with his will, and may we experience his goodness from our good, good Father, who is able to do immeasurably more than we can ask or imagine, according to his power at work within us. So let's allow him to work within us, even in our prayers, as we approach our Heavenly Father this week and beyond. God bless you. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much, Robbie. And perhaps you could pray now for us,
yeah,
and
sure.
Just let's seal that message to our heart and to our minds.
Yeah, sure. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Father, as we come before you, we want to come before you with that acknowledgement of who you are. Help us, Lord, just to always come before you with worship, with praise, with thanksgiving on our hearts. Father, help us to come before you with that submission of our will in preference to your will. And Father, help us to come before you with that dependence upon you to, you know what we need, but Lord, help us to have that dependence upon you to ask for what we need. And Father, help us just to hear what you have to say. Give us listening ears, Lord, so that we can understand your will, your word to us, so that we can pray into that in faith, knowing, Lord, that it will be fulfilled, and Lord, that you will give us more than we can ask or imagine, according to your power at work within us. And Lord, we just pray that if we're praying for something and it's not happening, Lord, that we would hear your voice, because maybe you want to give us something else, and help us to receive that and accept it as your good gift to us. Father, we just want to say we love you. You are our good, good Father. Help us to come before you as your children with that joy of wanting to please you, our good, good Father. Help us, Lord, as we come to you in prayer, to approach you in the right way, to give us that attitude of heart, Lord, just to hear your voice and to know what it is you're saying to us through our conversations with you. And we just pray this in Jesus' name, knowing that we come on the basis of what he's done for us, come on the basis of what he's doing for us, and we come on the basis of the relationship that we have with you now, Father, through him. And we pray this all to his honour and glory. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. So this week starts the new tighter restrictions, but not as tight as we have had, so we're grateful for that. But life groups that have been meeting together in gardens unfortunately won't manage that anymore, so we're back to Zooming for all our life groups. So we just encourage you to connect in. I know that we find it difficult, some of us find it more difficult than others to be Zooming after Zoom and Zoom and Zoom, and we're all kind of Zoomed out, so it feels, but we just really encourage you to press in, and because it's great to be able to study together as we dig deeper together through the week. And we're still allowed to meet up with other people, so we can still meet together and have a coffee with folk, and just encourage you to have that connection. I love a coffee. You like coffee.
Yes.
We like meeting people for coffee. So we just encourage that. Keep on meeting up when you can within the guidelines.
Yes.
Let's be above board
and
do the right thing.
Yeah, that's right. So let's just close our service with that wonderful prayer from the Ephesians 3. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than we ask or imagine, according to his power at work within us, to him be glory in the church, which is us, and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. God bless you, and we'll see you back here again very soon. Take care.